God's children together, trying to see where we belong, with hills and valleys to conquer. It's time we weather the storm. Everybody's looking for something, something they can hold on to.
Good morning. Thank you, Brother Paul, and good morning to all of the WIDU family, as well as those who are joining us via social media. Thank you for joining us for another segment of Mayor's Moment. I'm so excited today to have a very special guest. Many of you are familiar with him. He was the former mayor of the city of Fayetteville from 2005 to 2013. Mayor Tony Chavonne, good morning.
Good morning, Mayor Colvin, and thank you so much for having me here this morning, and thanks to the WIDU family for their continued efforts to make sure our citizens are informed and engaged.
Yes, sir. Well, thank you for joining us. Thank you for accepting the invite. I have a lot of people who are interested in our conversation today, so look forward to it. I don't want to belabor that, and certainly we have some interesting topics to get to, and an hour goes by very fast, but many people know you, but there are many who may be joining us who are not as familiar. You want to spend just a moment and tell us a little bit about yourself?
Sure. Thank you for that opportunity. I'm a native, born here and spent my entire life other than some college years. CPA, was with the newspaper here for 25 years and left there in 2004, and subsequently ran for mayor in 2005, and as you mentioned, was honored to serve our city for four terms and 8 years. And then after that, I've gone back and into business and created some businesses in the community, and thankfully had my sons to come back home and start to run those for me. So a blessed life by any measure.
Yes, sir. Well, thank you for that. Thank you for your service to the city. Mayor, we'll jump right in. We have a lot of people who are interested in your perspective on a number of issues that we're dealing with today. As we look at Fayetteville, as you said, you've been here all of your life with the exception of a few college years. Fayetteville past versus Fayetteville present. Talk on that a little bit about your perspective of where we were and where we are.
Yeah. Well, I think it's been a great journey, and we're in a much better place than we were for many measures. I mean, one of those, I think back and I hear so many of the comments about, well, this is the way it was. And I would just ask us all just kind of, let's just look at where we are. Not that it's not important where we were, but we're a different city. And I don't think we oftentimes spend enough time kind of celebrating that. When I was in high school here, the city couldn't grow for over two decades. So while you saw growth, the city of Fayetteville, I think, maybe had 60,000 people in the 1960s. Even when I was elected mayor, it had like 140,000 people. And now, Mitch, I think y'all are at 211 or something. So the city has grown dramatically in the period of time. And we're not that small town that we were for so many years, thankfully. I think that's been a really positive step forward. And demographically, the community has changed significantly. I think one of the biggest surprises people see when we start to really try to get the facts on the table, if you look at the registered voters in Fayetteville, North Carolina, 45% of them are African-American. I think 37% are white. That's a complete shift than it would have been at any time. That's not a negative. That's a positive. I think, again, we should celebrate that. We see that manifest itself in elections. We shouldn't be surprised when we're electing qualified candidates at all positions. We currently have a two-term sitting African-American mayor. Marshall Pitts did exactly the same thing. So 8 of our last 20 years, we've had at-large elected African-American mayors. We have a county commissioner chairman. We have a sheriff. We have a clerk of court. We have all kinds of qualified people that are winning at-large seats in our city, in a different city than it used to be, thankfully, and one that is leaning forward. And I think we should recognize that as we consider the best structure that we could have to have an effective local government.
Yeah, well, thank you for that, Mayor. And so, you know, I guess you kind of segued right into you know, the basis of the conversation today. Right. You and former council members and former Mayor Nat Robinson have an initiative called Vote Yes, where you're looking for 5,000 signatures on a petition to change the process that we use here in Cumberland County to at large. You know, there's a lot to be said about it, you know, and I'll be blunt about it. You know, for years, the system, during your 8-year tenure, I know you looked to to attempt that in 2007. Mm-hmm. You obtained the signatures, and then the Justice Department reviewed it and said that this was not consistent with the Section 5. And I have a copy of Attorney General Wayne Kim's report at that time. Mm-hmm. And some of the deficiencies that you all made, there was not a basis to really prove that. Mm-hmm. What has changed as to why you think now is the time for that? And I'll be honest with you, a number of people in the community, and I am of their opinion as well, that the council is getting a bit too diverse for many of the powers to be. Mm-hmm. That for all these years, 50 years, I think, when we talked about redistricting, there were only two or three African Americans that had represented the city, and then there was a change that happened. So, what is the basis of this request?
Okay, good. Well, a lot of questions there. Let me kind of back them up and begin with some history of the structure that we have. Up until 2000, the city council, which had actually grown to 13 members, had combinations of at-large and single member, as most 9 of 12 cities in North Carolina does, as the county commissioner, the school board, Hope Mills, and Spring Lake. Fayetteville had that as well, but it had grown to 13 members. There was an effort underway to reduce the size. A committee was formed charged with reducing the size. And they ultimately came out with a recommendation of something called multi-member districts, which I'm not really too familiar with, to be honest with the mayor, so don't really know it. But their advisor at that time said, no, I don't think that would pass the test. That's where the single-member district came from, the very first time in the year 2000. And the mayor was given the right to vote. Two big changes, and I think you and I would agree that's an mm-hmm, important right. positive change. Yeah. But the district plan that was put in place, the single-member district, all single-member district, we had not had that before. And in fact, it was never voted on by the city. It was approved by the city council based on a recommendation from a civil defense attorney, or civil attorney, and that was put in place. And Mayor Pitts was elected under that. His first term was under that model. 9 single-member districts, a 1 voting member mayor. Different than most cities in North Carolina, and different than every other governmental entity in Cumberland County, and different than the city of Fayetteville had been. Every structure has advantages and disadvantages, and I hope that as we discuss this, we can kind of set the personality aside and say, look, we're really just talking about the form of government that can be best representative of our community. So we have one that was put in place, never voted on. In fact, the only time our citizens have had the opportunity to vote on the local government that they wanted, they did in fact approve a combination. We're not talking about eliminating single member districts. Mm. We're just talking about converting some of the current 9 single member districts to at large so that the mayor, who currently is the only person accountable to everyone in the city, that there are other people on the council, which would end up being 4 of the 9 would be converted to single member, at large. There are other people in the city that in fact have to represent and reflect and be accountable to the entire city. That's the advantage of the at large model versus purely single member districts. So it's a combination of single member districts. There would still be 5. Some at large seats puts us back where the city had been, puts us back where 9 of 12 cities in North Carolina do, and every one of the governmental entities in Cumberland County do. So just to be clear on that, again, it's not doing away with that large, with single member, it's just having a combination as most effective governments seem to have.
Well, let's jump into that a little bit. Mm-hmm. So, you know, as we look at that, of course,
let me mention one thing because I don't want to lose my thought here. But when we said diversity, what we really, I guess the question is, are people dissatisfied that we have 9 African Americans on council? And I would just point back to 2006. I think we had 4. But the initiative was made then. The structure wasn't any more valid then than it is now. It's not got anything to do with the colors of the people in the room. It's the process they follow. So we didn't have the majority African-American council members when we first tried to do this because that structure, and I've led many, many nonprofits in this town, I led one of the major companies in this town, that structure of single member, 9 people representing individual pieces of the pie makes it extremely difficult to get traction on the big issues. That was true in 2006. It's true today. It has nothing to do with the color of the people in the room. It's a process flaw that that particular model is the weakness of that particular model, and I believe there's a better way.
So if that's the case, why didn't this conversation come up in 2013, 15, 17?
So 2013 was the year that the Supreme Court ruled that the Justice Department's policy was unconstitutional. So that kind of ended that boat then.
So 15 and 17?
Yeah, well.
19.
I don't really know that. I can't really say why it didn't come up.
Yeah, and so as you talk about that, you know, gerrymandering, as you talk about what that term is, some people may be familiar with it or not, but basically there are two basic principles of, of changing the process to give an advantage to one side or another. And so cracking and packing, I think they call it. One, the cracking is diluting the voting power of the opposing party's supporters across many districts. So as a part of your plan, you look to combine district, what, 3, 4, and 1?
No, there's not any plan for combining districts. That's not not what this effort would do. Ultimately, if this were successful, 5,000 signatures, gets on a ballot, everyone gets the opportunity to vote up or down.
Right.
And let's just say it goes through and passes like it did last time, which it passed 58% last time. Then the council that's in place at that time, they decide what the district looks like. There's no plans. It's not authority to a citizen-led petition to design the districts. It's just the number.
Right. Well, let me clarify. So you would replace the individual districts, at least four of them. Your proposal has 5 at-large seats or 4?
4.
Okay. So 4 at-large seats would take the place of 4 districts in some way. So you'd have to do some combination, correct?
The 9 single-member districts as they exist now under your council would be converted to 5 single-member districts.
Exactly. Yeah. So
there'd be some combination.
So there would be some merger of
that's
districts.
Not part of
right.
This.
Right. You're not saying that you all are proposing the specifics.
Although you're not even given the right to do that.
Yeah.
That's certainly not
So basically, it still would be, if you took, let's say, for instance, District 3 and 4 and combined it, instead of having 2 representatives or 2 votes, you would have 1. So wouldn't that be diluting the voting?
Well, I would say that every citizen in Fayetteville, North Carolina today, they have 2 votes. And if we are successful with this initiative, they would have 6. That's more representation. Every citizen in Fayetteville would have 6 city council members accountable to them. They would have 4 at large. A single member district representative, because they'd be in a district and they'd have the mayor, that, like you said, in. So they'd have 6 people they could vote for.
So how is it more effective to take one person to represent a larger number of people than it is for that person to deal with their district again?
Well, and that's an argument for
So isn't that gerrymandering?
No. Gerrymandering, if you look at our district maps that we have now, you know, we have had, it's not anything you did or I did.
We've
had them. You see the example of gerrymandering. When a district is drawn typically to meet racial quotas and minority districts and all that stuff that you have to do, and y'all have got to get ready to do it again. So the gerrymandering is when they get when there's no rhyme or reason to a district boundary because it has to be drawn for some arbitrary reason. I think you probably have seen Mr. Moan's comments about wouldn't it be wonderful if we just didn't do that, especially in a community that's as diverse as our city is. Wouldn't it be wonderful if you didn't have to draw these crazy lines that no one really even knows the district they're in? But that would be something that the council in place at that time would decide. But every citizen in Fayetteville would wake up every day and have 6 city council members accountable to them.
So, Mayor, I get that, but it would also make it so in Fayetteville, let's talk about the realities of what it takes to win a citywide election, okay? It takes resources. Even though social media has reduced that barrier, it's very expensive to cover 60-plus precincts and to get material out there. So basically, you have a world of those who have or can obtain and those who can't. So in Fayetteville right now, the poverty rate amongst African Americans is 25.8%, roughly, when Pathways did that.
Right.
Whites, 12%. Okay. Doesn't that create an unfair advantage by class, by people with resources? So in other words, the way that it used to work, the powers that be, the George Breeses, Mike Lyers, would write checks, go get candidates that supported their vision. They would make sure they had the resources and the means. Look at what happened to Charles Evans. Look at what happened to with Curtis Worthy and Val Applewhite and others people recruited them to align with their interests. Mm-hmm. Right now, the same thing would hold true, and you would have at least a 50% majority in that scenario to where means and resources determined the outcome. So how is that fair, and how is that more representation?
Well, we can just look at your recent race with the incumbent Nat Robertson.
Mm-hmm.
And as I recall, he raised almost twice as much money as you did, and you won. I don't think Charles Evelyn would describe himself as independently wealthy, and yet he's won an at-large county commission seat.
Right.
We have to face the fact. We might not like them, and that might not, that's fine, and we might disagree on it, but the facts of the matter are this community is electing African-American, not just wealthy African-American, and increasingly dollars are not making the difference. In fact, I didn't go back and look, but I would imagine the year I was leaving, and Kurt Debbia ran that. I forgot who all was in that. I would imagine Kurt probably raised more money than anybody. So increasingly, you're not seeing that as a factor as it might have been at one time when the city was relatively small. Much larger now. We should be proud of the fact that we're electing African Americans to at-large seats. And we have to also face the fact, Mayor, that 45% of our community, of the registered voters here, are African American. 37% are white. That's a fact. And we just need to acknowledge that, and that those all those facts need to be put in the table about, well, what is the best way forward. They're valid points, but there's a lot of valid points.
Right.
We are proving that we are electing African Americans citywide.
Right. So are you saying that, and then we'll take a break in a moment, are you saying that because there are more registered black voters that the process needs to change? Is that the basis for the change?
Isn't
that retrogressive?
No. I think it's just a reflection of our community.
Right. So we know what we are, but how does that speak to your point about the need to change? Have you noticed that there's some in the Justice Department assessment of the request? Attorney General Kim said that there was not a factual basis that a change needed to occur.
Right.
So this request comes pre-census data, the latest demographics. Mm-hmm. So what is the basis that requires or you're using to say that something needs to be adjusted?
Okay. Yeah, well, that's a great question. And this setting aside kind of the numbers.
Yes.
Okay. Who gets elected, who we're electing.
Right, so why the change now?
Okay. So I think we see more and more, and this has always been true. This is not just something that happened yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
But this has always been true. The flaw of a 100% single member district is districts where on average 1,300 people voted for to elect one of those representatives.
Okay.
That representative has exactly the same voting power you do as mayor. The big issues, the ones that perhaps are not impacting all the districts, the ones that maybe they're just so expensive, so complicated, whatever, big issues that you won't see the immediate impact on today, it's very difficult under this structure for them to get traction. There's a couple of examples. I think one of those that we've talked about, and I know this is something you're concerned about, is stormwater. Mm-hmm. How many districts in our city does stormwater really affect when it's all said and done?
Right.
$100 million needs to be raised to do this. Mm-hmm. Everybody's going to have to pay for stormwater. It's an expensive, you know, and the councils have argued over raising the fee 50 cents. Now, you remember, that's a great example of important issues that cities need to address for their citizens, but there's not enough traction because it really doesn't impact enough people to get it to the top of the list. So what happens, ironically, if we have the next flood, which we will, who do you think is going to die? Who do you think is going to die in the next flood? It is going to be the poor amongst us.
Sure.
Because we collectively have not been able to address the big issues here, and part of the, not all of it, but a contributing piece of that, there's not enough people in the room like Mitch or Marshall or Nat or Tony that are charged with looking at the big picture. And that makes it increasingly difficult for the leader, the mayor in your case, to be able to get traction on the big issue because people, they understand very quickly. I was elected in some cases by a few dozen people and only 1,300 people in my district voted. This is a big issue. I'm going to have to put a tax on everybody in the city to pay for stormwater. And out west, they will never suffer from a flood.
Right, right. So with that being said, Mayor, how is the process the problem, not the person? If you elect, or these districts elect people without vision,
mm-hmm.
without the ability to understand mm-hmm. that they are in a city or a community mm-hmm. that needs to be moving forward.
Yeah.
Because stormwater is not a new issue. It was around
it
under your administration.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's around now. We're spending more on it than we were crime. We've had this conversation, you and I, and with others. There's a 2013 crime report from WTVD showed that this was not a new issue. Fayetteville was higher ranking then. It has problems today. So why is it not the person? In fact, you know, participation speaks to us. You know, the responsibility of more than 1,300 people to participate in an election, or 13,000, or 1%, or whatever the number is you gave, speaks to this community's engagement to send qualified people to the table. Why does the process need to be fixed in order to change the person?
The structure needs to be the structure.
Okay.
I would say anyone that I think I can say this pretty generally. Anyone that I've ever seen elected to a city council seat would come in and say, well, I might be representing District 8 or 9, but I really represent the entire city.
Right.
And you've heard them say that. And they always say it when they're sworn. And I believe in my heart they believe that. But the structure over time reinforces the fact that you really need to worry about those 1,300. We might not like 1,300. We might wish it was 2,000, and we all do. But the reality of the situation is, Mitch, in those districts, 1,300 people are electing those representatives. And very soon, even good-intentioned people with the best intentions who want to serve the entire city, they find themselves making the decision, am I going to raise taxes to pay for a problem that doesn't impact these 1,300 people?
Right.
And am I going to be accountable to them at the next election in 2 years that I raised your stormwater tax, or I raised some other tax to fund more policemen, or whatever? But it does not impact their district. And that, over time, it reinforces people are smart. They figure that out. I keep these 1,300 people happy. I keep taxes low. I don't raise fees, whatever the case may be. That's how you get reelected. That is a structural deficiency to that model. It's not a personal thing.
Right.
It's just that model reinforces small thinking. And so, you're encouraged to think small, because those are the people you need to keep happy.
So Tony, why not have that conversation with the community? Winston-Salem, they had an overzealous representative that dropped the bill in the state without talking to the local elected officials. They are very similar in us to demographics. They have a real diverse city council, and they dropped the bill to change, to add three positions to their 8-member board at large. It was not received well because the community and the council didn't have the conversation.
Right.
They formed a commission.
Yeah.
They're working through it, and now they're looking to just add to the current situation.
Right.
Why did a few people who consider themselves, you know, pretty much the stakeholders here, make a decision that the process need to be changed? Why is it? Why is it to
the
a
structure?
The structure. Yeah. Why is it
and,
now?
And you know, that you might disagree with the philosophy there. I'll tell you the one. The names on that list all had served our city, representing over 50 years of service to the city, and worked under this structure. 50 years of service, including the mayor, who has worked under this structure twice as long as any other mayor. I think they're entitled to have an opinion.
Sure.
What, again, maybe this was an incorrect strategy. There was some thought that if we get involved with local elected people currently, it's going to set this stage up about, well, you're just mad because you lost. And in fact, if you go back the day that we announced this initiative, the very first comment, the very first question I received on the radio was, I see that three of these people on your list just lost last time and isn't just the spoiled grapes or whatever it is. So that was, again, might have been wrong, but that was the general idea, was we don't want this to be personal. We don't want this to be, well, I lost to that person, I'm angry about it, I'm going to change everything. We wanted it to be 50 years of experience of people who had seen this and said, look, this structure needs to be revisited. We have the opportunity. There's a process to allow us to do that. That's why that came out the way that it did. Again, perhaps, you know, in hindsight, maybe done differently, but that was the thinking.
Gotcha. All right. Well, you all have been tuning in for a great edition of Mayor's Moment with former Mayor Tony Chavonne. We will return in just a moment. We'll take a quick break, and we'll be right back with Mayor Chavonne. Thank you, Brother Paul, and welcome back to Mayor's Moment, joined with former Mayor Tony Chavonne. Tony, as we went to break, we talked about different perspectives about timing. Timing seems suspicious. You're familiar with, I'll say this, there has been a constant, I think, very strategic drumbeat in the media with up-and-coming and Bowman and others who attempt to paint a picture that Rome's on fire, that the leadership is not competent or capable of leading this community. And then comes a proposal to say we need to fix a problem that's been broken for a while. So how do you explain to the listeners today that this is not really the undertone of something different?
Great question. And I would say the timing, it couldn't be a worse time. Mm. It could not be a worse time. And I wish there was more flexibility in that. But the way the process works, and the state allows citizen-led petition for just a handful of things, one of those being a structural issue that you can do. And as you know, you have to collect 5,000 signatures, have to come be authenticated, come to the council for consideration, then the council is obligated to put it on the next ballot. We don't know when the next city election is. And had someone said, well, it's not going to be, till May or March or whenever, but we were running out of time. Mm-hmm. Because in order to make this process work, collecting 5,000 signatures in the middle of a pandemic is not an easy task.
Right.
It's also a terrible time recognizing this unfortunate stuff that's happening around the country about voting rights. I mean, it's a terrible time. It couldn't be a worse time.
Right.
But it is just the facts. Because this is a long-term change. This is not something that even happens in the short term. That makes it more difficult as well. To get 5,000 signatures, it would just put it on the next ballot that there is a city election. So let's just say, for the sake of argument, and it hasn't been changed, we'll just say that's November. Then the nine single-member districts will still be in place, and the mayor, in November, on the ballot, along with this referendum, if we're successful to get it on there. Let's say all those pass. Nine people get elected, mayor gets elected, and the referendum pass. It just means that this would make an impact in 2023.
Sure.
So this is a long-term thing. So the reason it started when it did, again, not just suspicious, but the worst time,
right,
was because it just takes time, and they never move November.
Right.
So we had to work hard, and we're in the middle of that process now to get five, and that was about as late as we could have started it. It's sad that all this other stuff is happening. It's unrelated to the specific articles you talked about. That's not part of my position, and that's not part of this initiative.
Right. So, you're watching what's going on throughout the South. Georgia
It's terrible.
Didn't go their way, and now the rules are changing, or the structure is changing, or process. Right. And so, of course, people should be suspicious.
Absolutely.
Because
now,
all the questions
are fair. I'm not in any way saying that's not a fair question.
Right.
I would just say, if we can just have the facts, and let's just put all the facts in front of it. And if we come to different conclusions based on facts, there's nothing wrong with that.
Right.
There's nothing wrong with it. But let's at least have the facts there, that everyone's seeing those. And then, hopefully we can make an informed decision, and, we'll stand with the results.
Yeah. So I look forward to us continuing that conversation. Mm-hmm. I'll move on for a moment to May 30th of last year, very bad day in the country, in our community particularly. You and I have had this conversation offline. You've been very outspoken a lot of times. I think, I understood the frustration of having your wife to make calls and being put in an uncomfortable situation. But let's talk a little bit about that and where we are. You served as mayor for a number of years, so you understand the structure of how our government is, that the police chief doesn't work for the mayor directly. You hire a city manager and so forth. And so when you talked about some of those things, didn't Marshall did an interesting article that just talked about where we are now, and he thought that a lot of what was being said was overblown. Tell us a little bit about, where you came with your positions from that period of time.
Relative to May 30th?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. It is different when it's personal.
Mm-hmm.
It is different. And I would say, to be honest with you, Mayor, had we not experienced May 30th collectively as a community last year, I wouldn't be here today. But I am. because it hurt. Not just because I was really scared for my wife, but what it was doing to our city. And we have spoken online, and I appreciate you calling me back and us having a dialogue about it. And I appreciate the structure of a city council and a city manager. But I would say everyone is accountable to somebody. And policies are accountable to somebody. And we can't, as a city, ever tell our citizens that we're not protecting them. And if someone has a policy, much like driving while black stops, if someone has a policy that's unfair to our citizens, someone who is accountable needs to stand up and address that. That's the one difference you and I see
right.
That differently.
Mm-hmm.
It is important for a city. In fact, I think it's yours. I'm sure it was ours. I think it's every council's number one strategic goal is public safety.
Right.
That's the fundamentals. The other stuff that we do, recycling, parks, they don't matter if people don't feel safe.
Sure.
And we have, that's why that touched such an emotional point for me, because it's the very basics of government. And we
right.
still haven't overcome that. That's still an issue for us in this city. And that bothers me, and I think it largely stemmed a lot from that night, not all, but I think that's a fundamental responsibility of local government, and I think we failed that night, and I'm hoping that we can move through addressing that.
So as you talk about that, and I'm certainly not here to defend mm-hmm. whatever the police chief's approach was,
right.
but as you know, as mayor, we don't tell the police what to do, particularly mm-hmm. in a time of crisis. Now, there are certain laws in the statute that give us certain special powers during an emergency, which
right.
we invoke those. But as you look at the tactics that were used, and I'm sure that it was a horrifying time to be going through it, if as you stated,
mm-hmm.
for your family. But as you look at the results at the end of the day,
mm-hmm.
Our damage compared to everywhere else, it was bad that anything was damaged.
Yep.
But there were no loss of life. The mm-hmm. injuries was one of the perpetrators,
right.
and Paul Wolverton, who was assaulted outside of the downtown area.
Yeah.
How do results not matter?
Yeah.
How can you say that? You know, it's like on the battlefield at the time of battle,
mm-hmm.
They're calling back to the Pentagon to say do something, and mm-hmm. of course. You have to trust the people who are on the ground. I'm not
right.
there. You're not there.
Right.
How do you look at the results?
Mm-hmm.
Our downtown is thriving, but there continues to be a message right now that it's not.
Mm-hmm.
Property values are up 12.5% according to a
mm-hmm.
recent report from Cool Springs, but they're saying that they were detracted and no one's coming. Why are these false narratives being attached to this particular council?
Right. A lot of stuff there too. So let me kind of go
yes,
back.
Sir.
Yeah, thank you. someone made the comment not too long after May 30th. Well, no one died. That's not the only litmus test for local government. And I would say we lost something that night in our city that we have yet to regain. And we can blame it on newspaper columns, and we can blame it on people's false narratives. But we lost something that night. It's going to take us a while to regain. And it is a very difficult job to be a police officer or a police chief. And I'm not criticizing the people.
Mm.
I know it's a difficult job, but you've got to be able to walk and chew gum at the same time.
Right.
I don't think you have to compromise answering a 911 call. There's a line there, that's just my personal opinion. I think we suffered greatly that night that maybe is not reflected obviously in deaths and maybe not in property damage, but we in many ways suffered something even greater than that. And that, we can rebuild buildings, you can get past things that happen, but when the confidence in local government's basic responsibility to its citizens is lost, it takes a long time to overcome that. And I'll give you a parallel, because I know these are hard decisions. They're very difficult decisions for mayors and elected people to make, and city staff. We were presented with a similar situation, and I heard a lot of the very same arguments. We had a very aggressive traffic stop program under a previous police chief that we met with, 20 times for over a 6 or 9 month period to try to understand better. And ultimately,
the city council, the elected people, had to stand up and stop it. And that's not the way it should work. And ultimately, that police chief's not with us, and neither is the city manager. But the people accountable to the citizens, the people who have to answer to them every 2 years at the ballot box, they stood up and did the right thing. And sometimes that's what it takes.
Yeah. So I appreciate you mentioning that, because I was certainly going to mention that the thing that you say was lost was the confidence and the feeling of safety. For a long time, that's what members of the black community have felt.
Yes.
There's a loss of confidence in those who police them and protect them. They feel that their leaders and the people who they elect, that they know out of these districts, that they've grown up with, have their interests in mind, that if they come from a certain community, that they understand the needs of it better than someone who doesn't. And so that, to me, is tied directly to what we started this conversation with, is the people that you have at the table. What perspective do they have? Do they share more of your perspective and the needs of your community or not? I've served as a council member, unlike yourself, I represented districts, and then I represented the city, and I've seen both sides. Right. And it all does fit together, that you can't have, the problem is that you can't have a situation where all of the focus is about moving the whole city forward while you're leaving neighborhoods and communities behind. That's been the problem. That is our problem. That's why people depend to me on local government. You have that with the state. We have state representatives that represent a big, big area of 40,000-50,000 people.
Right.
To me, I think who we have at the table matters. Now, I will say this, that there are some people who probably could do a better job at their job and who need to understand their job better. But even with you, during your eight-year tenure, I don't think you faced the type of things that we've experienced in the last 18, 24 months. I don't remember you having a pandemic. I don't recall you having civil unrest. And I don't recall you having an economy that was on the brink of collapse. So how do you not say that it takes time to see the performance of these people?
I'm not talking about these people.
Okay.
And I'm not here to criticize any one of these people.
Right. Or that's, a district structure.
Yeah, okay. Well, I'll give you some examples again, not personal, just a structural issue. Big issues who do impact some of the individual districts who can't get traction. And we're on one right now. We're on the corridor. You and I have had this discussion before. If I leave here right now and drive to get to the major gateway to our city, 295, I'm going to drive through Beirut, Shaw Heights.
Beirut in, I mean, Lebanon, Beirut?
Yeah.
So what is it? What's Beirut like about that?
Well, no water and no sewer, people living in poverty and people not in the city.
Oh, yeah.
And we have not been able, that's in a district. That is in a district, in a major corridor that we should all be concerned about.
Well, it's not a city council district.
Well, it should be.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Have you ever been to Orlando?
Yeah.
And do you think when you leave Orlando Airport and you're driving to Disney World, do you drive through what we force people? Are we having citizens who are living in Shaw Heights? Now, we should be embarrassed about that.
We should, Mayor, but
that's a district.
Right.
That's a, where's that district rep at?
It would. What you mean, Shaw Heights? A county commissioner.
Where is the corridor's district reps who care about the corridor? And we would all agree that if Shaw Heights was in the city and those standards were there and those people were better protected and it was a better area, that would benefit Murchison Road. Where are those district representatives at?
Well, Mayor, you came in on the heels of annexation. Marshall Pitts paid a political price for something that moved us forward, leapfrogged us forward by doing something that was not politically in his advantage. You came on the heels of that.
Mm-hmm.
Where was the passion about Beirut, as you call it, and the other 15 donut holes to say that people without means deserve the same quality of life as people with means?
Because I was spending my time building a transit system and tearing down dilapidated housing authority.
Yeah, a lot of work could be done, correct?
And paving dirt roads.
Yeah.
That's what I was doing.
Yeah. So a lot of work in the vineyard, right?
Yeah.
But you had 8 years of that passion, we had that, but what was your point about the representation that they have or don't have?
Well, you had made the point that one of the advantages of purely single-member districts is they understand the police better, they understand their needs better.
Their community as well.
Their community,
right,
in their area.
Mm-hmm.
And I would say, in the big issues, having one district rep, if they in fact do what you say, understand mm-hmm. they're better, can we really look at this corridor and say in the 20 years that we've had this structure that this corridor is any better off? Have we addressed that donut hole? And we were the first council to identify the donut hole. Have mm-hmm. we addressed that donut hole that stands between us and the major gateway to this city while we've had single member districts protecting their neighborhood? No. The big issues don't get done. The big issues don't get done because it takes having people to come together. It takes vision, and it takes a combination, not all, but at least more people at the table looking at the big picture. Annexing Shaw Heights, if we're ever able to do that, and every staff member told me this, and I'm sure they've told you that, man, mm-hmm. it's going to cost money.
Right.
You know, it's going to cost money mm-hmm. to extend water and sewer in the Shaw Heights. It absolutely is. That's going to be hard to get traction because Shaw Heights is only going to be in one person's district. That's a great example of a big issue that we can all agree needs to be done. But why is someone in the other eight districts going to be willing to increase taxes or fees or whatever combination of those or take money from one budget to the other to do something that's only going to impact one district? That is an example of why this.
Are you making the argument that every decision is based on the benefit to the ward? I mean, no, because if that's the case,
well,
then you've wasted.
I think there's a good comment. We don't have the combination now. I'm not saying do away with ward. I don't really like that word, but I know what you mean.
Right.
Call it
uh-huh.
that. I think that's the official word.
Yeah.
This is not doing away with wards.
Right.
It's saying, can some of the voices at the table, can some of the voices at the table be charged with the big picture? Can they be accountable to a larger group of people? So there's a combination of the ward, there's a combination of at large, so it's easier to make those bigger decisions because you have more voices at the table.
Okay.
That's the structural question for debate.
Well, I got you. I guess we'll have to leave it there. We're about.
Well, I hope we can come back.
We can. It's a lot to talk about. We mm-hmm. we cover a lot of ground, but there's so many more things that mm-hmm. You and I need to talk about. And the listening audience, they're sending comments and questions, and mm-hmm. so I'll look for a follow up of that. So I hope that you'll accept the invitation to come back.
Yeah, I would welcome it. Thank you. For that.
I appreciate it. You know, we were a little. I got a couple of texts. It was like this will be civil tomorrow. So I said, look. It's able to agree and disagree with people in a way.
And you know, we should all aspire for that. And you have always been that way. I hope I have with you, Mayor.
Yeah.
And certainly that's the way I hope today went.
I do appreciate that. I think we covered a lot of ground, and we'll continue this conversation. We will. I do have this question that continues to come up. So I think the election may be March. It may be November.
This November?
If it stays on track, it would be November of 21.
Right.
There's a Senate bill that's getting good traction, mm-hmm. To use your word, through the process now that may make the election in March.
Yes.
A lot of people want to know, will you and I face off in the next election? They want to know if you're doing this to open the door back to...
Yeah, 100% of my focus right now is getting 5,000 people so that I can give every citizen in this community the opportunity to vote for the kind of government they want.
Right.
That's 100% of my focus.
That's a good political answer. All right. Well, we'll see when time comes. But Mayor Tony, Mayor, we've said it a number of times, former Mayor. Appreciate you coming. Appreciate you spending a little time with us on Mayor's Moment. Look forward to the follow-up.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Yes, sir. Folks, we'll take a few-minute break. We'll come back with just catch you up on where we are with some current events and to end it and talk about next week's show. We'll be back in 2 minutes. Thank you. Thank you, Paul, and thank you for joining us for another great segment of Mayor's Moment. Great conversation with Tony Chavonne, former mayor of the city of Fayetteville. You all sent a lot of information. I hope we covered a lot of ground that you wanted to know as we talk about this Vote Yes initiative that Mayor Chavonne and the other former council members and mayors are proposing. And so with that, if they receive 5,000 signatures, the city council, by law, will have to place it on the ballot, which will take place at the next election. So we'll see how it goes. You'll probably receive things in the mail. So trying to educate you to make sure that you're empowered, we believe that's very, very important to you making decisions that will not only affect this next election, but could potentially affect this community for a long time. The last thing we want to do is regress, guys. We talked a little bit about the narrative that some push out to make it look like that this, you know, although the mayor said his position was about the structure and not the people, there are a number of things that unrelated to him that are being said about the people and what they look like and who they represent and what their interests are. This is not new. It happened during Reconstruction. After slavery ended, Reconstruction came about, and there was a very accelerated advancement of African Americans in leadership, political leadership. And it was terrible, the things that were said about them, to discredit them and to say that they were not prepared to govern. And so Google it sometime. It's interesting reading. Look at what happened in Wilmington, where the leadership at that time was African American at the turn of the century. Some terrible things were done in Wilmington to change that dynamic. We had a 100-year anniversary of the Tulsa situation, and what happened to those people in Tulsa, Oklahoma, was a catastrophe. And now we're looking at what's happening in Georgia and Texas and other places across the South. So let's stay woke, make sure that we stay informed, and we know what it is that we're up against here. And so with that, we'll say that the city council is anticipated at the next meeting, formal council meeting, that will adopt the budget. There are great things in the budget. There are resources that will come into this community, over $30+ million that will come in from the federal government to help our community stand back up and to move forward. And so we will have conversations with the other elected bodies in the county and the school board, hopefully, to talk about how it is that we put our resources in the same direction to move our community forward. Those are some of the things that are coming up. Tonight we'll have a meeting that will talk about a report from Locks Creek. It's an area in District 2 that is prone to a lot of stormwater. It has been for several years, even under this current administration and others, hasn't received the resources it needs. It's needed to survive, and so we're trying to fix that. But we have a $200-300 million problem, guys, and we're trying to catch up to years of underfunding and neglect. And so we're working through some of these challenges and problems, but we'll need you. We want to keep you informed and engaged. Again, this has been a wonderful day of Mayor's Moment. You guys have sent some great comments and questions. I tried to steer the conversation to make sure that we answered those questions. We were not able to open the phone lines up and take calls. I thought it was more beneficial for us to continue that engagement so that we can make sure we covered the different perspectives. And so at the end of the day, you'll make the decision as to whether what's working or the structure that's been used since the Department of Justice has said that was what was needed or not. And get informed and get more information, and I'll share as much as I can. So, again, this has been another great episode of Mayor's Moment. I'm Mayor Mitch Colvin. Thank you for joining me. I look forward to speaking with you soon. Please share today's show on your social media platforms to others so that we can encourage more people to tune in and be informed of Mayor's Moment. And if God's willing, I'll see you next Monday.
The audacity to hope for what we can and must achieve tomorrow.
There is a place for us, for all the world.
What we know, what we have seen, is that America can change. That is the true genius of this nation. What we have already achieved gives us hope, the audacity to hope, for what we can and must achieve tomorrow.